Welcome to C3 San Diego. Need something fresh, real, and powerful in your life? Connect with us on social media, get live stream service notifications, podcasts, and up-to-date information on upcoming events. We are so glad you're joining us for a powerful, life-transforming message from one of our C3 San Diego pastors. We would love to hear about how God is impacting your life through this ministry. Please share your experience with us at info@c3sandiego.com. If you'd like to be a part of what C3 Church is doing in the city of San Diego and beyond, you can contribute financially by going to c3give.com and choosing the giving option that works best for you. We hope you enjoy this message.
Well, I was thinking about what movie I could use as my inspiration for today's message, and I'm sorry to say that it's not a Christmas movie. I'm sure that you will have one of those in the weeks leading up to Christmas in this series. But for me, I'm all about the action flicks. Okay, I don't want to betray my gender, but you know that it's the chick flicks and the rom-coms, they just don't do it for me. 'Cause I've seen the damage of what those movies bring forth in a human life, and I'm like, I can't be entertained by that. And the whole time I'm sitting there watching most rom-coms, I'm just judging the people over what they're doing. I'm like, this isn't good. So I am an action person. And the way for me to enjoy a movie is, of course, bring in some action. Yep, throw in a love story, but add some real life history, a true life story to that, and I am hooked. Now, if you're looking for probably what I believe one of the best historical action flicks of all time, look no further than The Patriot. Yes. OMG, baby. Like, just amazing. I don't know if Mel Gibson has made a bad movie. And if he has, I don't want to know about it. I mean, in fact, they're just all degrees of good. They're either good, very good, or freaking awesome. Like, Braveheart level. So it is incredible. And anyway, I love this movie, The Patriot, because really it sums up the antithesis of really what America is. It was a land that fought for its own liberation. And so, of course, the movie The Patriot is set in the late 1700s when the American colonialists were fighting for their independence from the British, which I think actually still the English are quite a little bit mad about, but oh well. Rock on, America. So I love the movie. At the end, there's this beautiful scene where they're standing and it's very clear the war has turned, and Ben Martin, who is Mel Gibson's character, is standing at the shoreline as the French ships are coming in, which really does signal the end of the war. Reinforcements have come. And Mel Gibson looks out at the ocean, the horizon, and sees these French ships coming in, and you know, they just know victory is imminent. And he turns to his compatriot there, a Frenchman who had joined the fight for independence, and he says, "Vive la France." But then his French friend turns back to him and says, "No, vive la liberté." And I'm like, that is America right there. That is America. Liberty and justice. I'm telling you today, the Christian life is a little like that. You know, and the greatest liberationist wasn't Mel Gibson. It's not the American armed forces. It's not even the French. It's Jesus Christ. We serve the greatest liberationist of all time. And the great thing about our God is he didn't kind of set us free and then leave us helpless and vulnerable. The Bible tells us that those who the Son sets free are free indeed. Okay, so when Jesus left the earth and set us free and broke the power of sin and death on the cross, he didn't kind of just take off and then go, fingers crossed, hope everything's okay. You know what he did? He actually gave us tools to make sure that we could stay free. Because there are oppressors that try to come in and put us back in chains and slavery again. And so God is a good father. He's not a deadbeat dad. So he's like, you know what, I'm going to set you free. And then I'm also going to give you tools so you can continually establish your freedom when the enemy comes in like a flood. So today I'm going to talk about three great liberators you and I possess as God's kids. You ready? You ready? We're going to go through these strong because I'm going to pray for people this morning. Okay. The first one is the Word of God. Somebody say the Word of God. So the Bible tells us in the book of James that the Word of God is like our mirror. It says when we look into the Word of God, it is a reflection of who we are. But I got to tell you something, in this world today, because we're on the wrong side of eternity, most of us will grow up having our identity shaped by our parents, by our society, by our friends, and by the current culture. But God is actually saying, you know what, I don't want you to get your identity affirmed from the forces that are around you. I want you to get your identity affirmed through the Word of God. Amen. And some of us are going to have to go on a little bit of a trip of unlearning things. I know I did. Look, I grew up being told, and oftentimes people say this in the most casual, kind of not meaning to harm you ways, but so they speak sticky words that stick to your spirit. And I remember growing up being told consistently, almost in jest, oh, she's such a dumb blonde, she's so dizzy, she's just not all that bright, thank God she's pretty, you know, maybe she can marry somebody smart, you know, something along those lines. So I grew up my whole life thinking that I was not an intelligent person. And how many people know if you believe the words spoken over you, you will act down to them? However, God is saying, I want you to liberate yourself from the lie that the enemy has told and spoken you over your life and start to live up to the Word of God. So I had to go on a process of unlearning. There were times where I had to find a word in the Bible because I would find myself doing dizzy, blonde things all the time. And then I'd say, well, it's because I'm dizzy and blonde. And then the Lord reminded me, you are not the reflection of what man has said you are. You are a reflection of what I have said you are. And you know what I realized? Jesus was very intelligent. He was very witty. He knew the right thing to say at the right time. He always had the perfect answer. He was never caught unawares. He was brilliant. He was smart. And the Bible tells me in the book of 1 Corinthians that I have the mind of Christ. So if Jesus was all those things, then when I look into the mirror of God's word, I realize I'm those things too. Amen. I wonder what new things you need to rehearse over your life to dismantle the lie that the enemy has tried to use to keep you captive. What word do you need to find and speak over yourself to remind yourself of who you truly are? I remember, you know, going into ministry and being so intimidated. Because I left school in the 10th grade, I didn't go to college, and I'd been told my whole life by various people that I just didn't have what it takes as it relates to intellect, you know, I would feel massively intimidated in situations like this. And so I started to try to find myself in the Word of God. And I'd flip to the book of Jeremiah, where God comes to Jeremiah and he says, Jeremiah, you're going to do these great things. But of course, he's been told he's too young. So the first thing he says is, alas, O Lord, I cannot do what you've told me because I am a youth. And then God responds to him with this, do not say you are too young. Do you know there are some things you are not allowed to say about you? And I wonder how many of us have been cursing ourselves as we speak the lies that the enemy has whispered instead of the truth reflected about us in God's word. Can you imagine how that would change our earth right now? Identity issues up the yin yang, all over the place. I'm telling you, when we get a revelation through God's word of who we truly are, we will become the person we were always meant to be. Listen, I may not have a college degree. I may not have been to Harvard. I may not have been to a fancy school, but I tell you what, I am a reflection of what God's word says I am. And through him, my weaknesses have been turned into strengths as I've started myself to allow myself to see myself as a reflection, not of the words that men have spoken over me, but the words of my Heavenly Father. So I would speak words like what God spoke to Jeremiah. And I would say, I am a prophet to the nations. God has put his words in my mouth. I am intelligent. I am witty. I am sharp. I wonder what words in God's word you need to remind yourself of who you are today. Who you truly are. You know, because the enemy sold so many people a whammy, and we can see since the beginning of time, he's been doing it. So in the book of Genesis, the first thing, it's his oldest trick in the book. He comes to Eve and he says, you know, if you eat from this tree, you will be like God. And it sounds awesome. Yeah. Who wouldn't want to be like God, right? But here was the problem. She was already like God. She was created, as the Bible says, God created them in his image and likeness. So the enemy had her convinced she wasn't something she already was and got her into a striving and performance mode and compromise to become something she already was. So strange. And we take his bait every time. But I'm telling you today, what will liberate you at the point of your true identity is getting this word on the inside of you. Only the word of God can reveal your true identity. I love the story of a woman by the name of Rosaria Champagne Butterfield. Okay, now that's a name right there. Sounds like she was born for the stage. Okay, so she used to be an English professor and a gay activist. She was a homosexual woman. And she was wanting to write a story exposing religious people and the hypocrisy of the Bible. She said she didn't like Christians, so in order to expose what she believed was the deception of the scriptures, she thought she needed to grab a hold and read the very book that she wanted to dismantle in order to get her ammunition. But an interesting thing happened when Rosaria Champagne Butterfield picked up that Bible. Here's what she said. When I looked in the mirror, I looked like the same person I always was. But when I looked into my heart through the lens of the Bible, just like the Bible says in the book of James, staring at our reflection and studying it. When you study this word, my friends, you will find out who you truly are. But when I looked into my heart through the lens of the Bible, I wondered, am I a lesbian? Or has this all been a case of mistaken identity? Turn to the person next to you now. We're going to take a minute and I want you to say, are you suffering with a case of mistaken identity? Uh-oh. I know I did. Says, if Jesus could split the world asunder, divide marrow from soul. Remember, this is an atheistic woman who was looking for every reason to discredit this book. And yet when she read the pages, when she saw herself in its pages, she was transformed. Could he make my true identity prevail? Who am I? Who will God have me be? Then one ordinary day, I came to Jesus, open-handed and vulnerable, and I was broken, and I was in a broken mess. I did not want to lose everything that I had known and everything that I had loved, but the words of God sang a sanguine love song in the rubble of my world. I weakly admitted that if Jesus could conquer death, he could make my world right too. And today I live in the shelter of a covenant family where one man calls me wife and many call me mother. My friends, that's why we have to go to God's words as the greatest source of our identity, because men get it wrong. Men get it wrong. And the great thing about us coming to Christ is that we get born again, which is really just what it claims to be. See, you might have all kinds of dysfunction in your natural family tree. But baby, you've been grafted into a new family tree now. I'm going to tell. Because here's the thing. I went for a medical test where I had to answer all these questions. And they're asking me questions like, is there mental illness in your family? And the truth is, in the natural, yes. Is there depression in your family? And the truth is, in the natural, yes, there was. Is there heart disease in your family? And the truth in the natural was, yes, there was. But you know what? I'm part of a different family now. So I looked at that page and I kind of had a bit of a conundrum. Do I give the doctor what he wants? Do I give him the facts or do I give him the truth? And so I started to look through. God, did you ever have any mental illness? Let me see. Does my daddy... See, because some of us have been comparing ourselves to the wrong father. And you're letting your identity be shaped by the missteps of your natural family line instead of the perfection of your heavenly Father. And the Bible says that we have been predestined to be transformed or conformed into the image of His Son. Don't compare yourself to the wrong father. God didn't have mental illness to give you. He didn't have depression to give you. And He sure as heck doesn't have heart disease. So when you get to that medical office, nope, 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 nope. None of that's in my history. I've been grafted into a new family tree today. You are not the sum total of your parents' mistakes and missteps or the forces of your biological birth. You have been born again, my friend. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. Okay. So the second way that the word liberates us is it's a weapon. It's a weapon. And see, we can try to be super passive as Christians, but it just shows your biblical illiteracy if you try to be passive. Because in Ephesians 6, the Bible talks about our weaponry. It talks about our armory. Okay, so God in His infinite wisdom knew that in order for my people to stay free, I'm going to have to give them a spiritual Second Amendment. The right to bear some arms. That's why He said in Ephesians 6, I'm going to leave you with the sword of the Spirit. Amen. Didn't say the journal of the Spirit. Didn't say the notepad of the Spirit. The Starbucks card of the Spirit, where you can sit down with your enemies and hopefully reason with them and rationalize with them. He said, no, my dear children, I'm going to give you a freaking sword. We can win battles with the Word of God. You will win battles with the Word of God. Your battle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. We don't fight spiritual enemies and spiritual battles with natural means. We fight them with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I love it in the movie The Patriot. When the enemy comes in, the evil Colonel Tavington. Rah, 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 rah. Okay, so you've got to watch this movie. It's a great movie. I would love to show clips, but it is so violent. I'm like, oh, I want to show that. Oh, hang on, no, somebody gets hit with a cannonball. Oh, I want to show, oh, no, bayonet to the heart. Oh, I want to show, oh, yeah, he gets his head chopped up, I can't. Okay, so you're just going to have to believe me. Go watch it later, all right? Great movie. So when the enemy comes in like a flood and Ben Martin's son is killed, you know what he doesn't do? Cry himself to sleep. You know what he doesn't do when the enemy comes in like a flood? He doesn't write in his journal about his feelings. He goes up into his chest, he opens it up, and he pulls out a hatchet and a gun. And then he goes and he takes care of business. Some of us need to start taking care of some business in the Spirit and picking up the sword, which our Heavenly Father left for us to make sure that we stayed free and we stayed liberated. So what word, what sword do you need to sharpen today, my friends? Because as sure as I'm standing here, if you have not faced a battle in your lifetime where you have to fight for your own life, your own health, your family, your mental health, your finances, you will. And I'm not saying that to be a prophet of doom. I'm saying that because I know that we live on the wrong side of eternity. And there will be battles that you and I have to fight. But God has not left us vulnerable and He's not left us unarmed. He's left us with His word, and His word will win battles for us. I remember when my son was going through a very heartbreaking, rebellious time, making a lot of decisions that were breaking my heart, breaking my husband's heart. You know, it was a very dark time in our family's life. And, you know, everything in me kind of wanted to crawl up in the fetal position and just hope that it went away. But it was then that I started to learn to fight. I had to become a warrior in the Spirit. And God said to me, Leanne, I want you to sharpen your sword. When you want to confess that it's hopeless, when you want to speak what you see or what the devil says about the situation, I want you to pull out your sword. And he handed me a sword in the form of Psalm 1. And he said, every time the enemy comes against you and every time you feel helpless or defeated, I want you to use this sword against the enemy. And so I started prophesying Psalm 1 into my son's life. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But his delight will be in the law of the Lord. And in that law, he will meditate day and night. He will be like a tree, devil, you hear me? Planted by rivers of living water, and he will bring forth his fruit in season, and everything he does will prosper. I'm telling you, every time I wielded that sword, I did damage to the enemy's kingdom, and I absolutely revolutionized the way my son's future looked. Some of us need to sharpen our swords. What weapon do you need to pull out of its sheath today, friends? Scare the enemy off with that sword of the Spirit. You know, when my little girl, when I was pregnant with my little girl, my fourth child, Zoe, she was given a death sentence in the womb. And they said, if she is born full term, more than likely she will be born with such severe complications, life will be very hard. And they said, we really would like to give you the option of terminating the pregnancy. And I remember when that happened, and again, it was one of the darkest times of my life. But see, friends, I had a window to fight. I had a window of time to believe God for things to be different. And so again, excuse me, God gave me a sword. He gave me a weapon in the form of Psalm 139. And every evening and every time I felt afraid, I would put my hand on my stomach and I would say, thank you, Lord. She is skillfully put together in my womb. Father, I thank you that she is fearfully and wonderfully made, and that my soul knows very well. And friends, there were times that my soul didn't know that very well. There are times when I was literally speaking those things that weren't as though they were. And my belief system had to shift. And it happened over the course of the next few months. Every time I would prophesy and pray that scripture over my womb, believing for things to shift. And on August 17th, 2008, I gave birth to a beautifully healthy baby girl. Somebody give glory to God. I'll drink to that. I'm telling you, God has given us weaponry to fight off oppressors. Friends, do not be negligent at the point of the word. It is your weapon. You need it. Digest it. Get it on the inside of you and fight the devil off in Jesus' name. Do not let him put you or your family in chains again. Somebody say glory. Hallelujah. Come on. Yes. All right. Somebody just shout because it's good to shout. Wow. Come on. I just felt like, you know, like a scene out of Braveheart right there. Okay, the second great liberator that you and I have, and there are many, but I'm going to really focus on three today, is praise to God. Praise is an incredible liberator. And can I have a soapbox moment with everybody today? Yeah. It's not in the Bible, but I'm just going to go ahead and say it, all right? Okay. I feel like we could have a little bit of an overlove with sad worship songs. I feel like we need a praise revival, don't you? Here's the thing. When I talk to a lot of songwriters, they will say that typically worship songs are a lot easier to write. Praise songs, markedly harder. Do you know why? Because the human soul is so conditioned toward lament and so conditioned toward melancholy and so conditioned toward, Lord, I'm nothing, I'm a worm, I'm a slug, and thank God that... But the Bible says, I want you to put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. And we all know the story in Acts where Paul and Silas had been beaten black and blue for their faith, stripped naked, very bad day. Turn the person next to you and say, that's a bad day. Okay. Thrown in prison for their faith. And then in the midst of this moment where everyone around them would have expected them to sing the song of a victim, the Bible says everyone was amazed as they shouted and sang a robust hymn to God. Yes. Somebody say a robust hymn. Come on, if you're sad and down in the dumps, turn off the sappy worship song that wants to remind you of how alone you are. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows my sorrow. Okay, you sound like Scar from The Lion King. You gotta change the channel, friends. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Listen, turn on The Power of the Cross by C3 Live and start to remind yourself of how amazing your God is. Magnify God in the midst of your problems. And we see that Paul and Silas did exactly that, and then the prison doors flung open. Their chains fell off, and God busted into the jailhouse, and everybody was set free. So sometimes we can read these stories in the Bible and we can be so anesthetized to how powerful they are. I mean, we read this and we're like, oh, yeah, oh, so lovely, so nice. Oh, they were in jail for their faith, and then they decided to praise and sing robust hymns to God. And then God busted in and broke them out. Isn't that just a terrific story? Okay, no, not the right level of emotion and excitement around something like that. So you mean to tell me, Bible, that if I am imprisoned with something, if I am captive to something, if I am in bondage to something, if I am in an impossible situation, that I can lift up my praise to God and God will be so eager to join in that he will bust into the prison and the prison doors will swing wide open. I'm telling you, something will shift if you turn your dial from victim to praise. Start to praise God. It's not about what's happening to you. It's about how awesome he is. He has the ability to turn your mountain into a molehill. I remember, oh my gosh, all the stories I could tell, Dr. Zeus. Many years ago, my husband and I building our second home. I was pregnant with my second son, heavily pregnant. The money ran out, the contractors left, the project manager did the dirty on us. We were alone. I was heavily pregnant. We had no money. It looked like we were not going to be able to get into this home. We were paying rent on another house while we were paying a mortgage on our new house, and it was a lot for two little youth pastors earning $20,000 a year. And I remember driving to the work site because at this point it was left to Jürgen and I to put this house together. And I'm telling you, by the grace of God, that thing is still standing, okay? I'm sure there are some angels positioned there from now until eternity. Hold up those beams. But anyway, I was driving to the work site, and I remember I just felt the greatest temptation I believe I've ever felt in my life to curse the situation. You know, sometimes it feels so good just to speak the reality. I just want to say what's really happening. And it was like the devil was standing at the doorway of my mouth, just like, curse it, curse it, curse it. Say you hate your husband. Say this was a stupid idea. Say you're an idiot. Say this was so lofty. Say that this was a ridiculous notion. Say what were we thinking? Say this is never going to work out. Say this is hopeless. But just as quickly as the enemy was whispering these thoughts into my ear that I so desperately wanted to act on, I felt the Holy Spirit turn up and say, Leanne, remember the scripture in Proverbs. Those who guard their lips will guard their lives, but those who speak rashly will come to ruin. And then he said to me, Leanne, don't curse what I've called you to bless. Praise me for your finished house. And I tell you, it was hard. It was hard work because everything in me wanted to say exactly what the enemy had been implanting in my head. But I had to turn my dish from victim, from melancholy, from down in the dumps, from impossible to the all things are possible network, because with God, all things shall be possible. And I'm telling you, I shifted my dial to the dial of praise, and by the skin of our teeth, 2 days before my son was born, we moved into that home. We had carpet on the floor. We had running water and electricity. That was enough for me. Glory, hallelujah. God turned the tide because he taught me a very valuable lesson on the power of praise. My gosh, I reckon there are some people here, your lives are going to change if your confession changes. If you start to praise God for who he is in the midst of your very impossible situation and circumstance. God wants to turn things around, but he must be able to arrest your mouth and get you to say what he says, not what your flesh says, in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen to that? Yes. Intentionally set your default position to praise instead of complaint. You know, the Bible doesn't give us permission to verbally vent. I've looked for it. I've tried to find the clause that says, you know, a couple of times a year, you know, in different seasons and cycles, you're allowed to like freak out and verbally bash the people around you. Okay, I've searched the scriptures. I have stayed up night after night trying to find that one, but alas, it is just not there. But I look at the Psalms and I think, and I say to God, well, look how David spoke. And he said, yes, he was talking to me. See, you're allowed to lift up your complaint to the Lord, but too many of us lift up our complaint to our neighbor, to our husband, to our friends, to our girlfriend. And then by the time you're done, people look at you and they run the other direction. Like, oh, here she comes. Lord have mercy. I'm running in the other direction because you open your mouth out and it's like, bleh. Verbal diarrhea all over the place. You know, like, we've got to learn to arrest our tongues and start to speak and praise God in the midst of whatever circumstance we're going into. Not because he's some kind of narcissist, but because we need to remind ourselves of who God is. There's a beautiful psalm in the Bible, Psalm 103, where David literally writes a psalm to remind himself of how powerful and big his God was. Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. Oh, Selah. Let's take a minute. Well, that's hitting me where it hurts. May I never forget the good things he does for me. You know what? We can be so well versed with our disappointments and our I don't haves and our I wish I hads that we cease to remember the good things that God has done for us. What a great season to remember again. He forgives all my sins. Whoa, somebody needs to shout about that because you're just looking way too unimpressed. Come on. He forgives all our sins and heals all my diseases. All right, somebody needs to lift their hands and thank the Lord for all the good things he has done. He's forgiven our sins. He's healed our diseases. This is good news today. He redeems me from death, bonus, and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. And everybody over 40 said, amen. Amen. Isn't that good news? Don't need Botox when you got Jesus. Something's going to happen when we shift our dial from complaint to praise. Turn off the sappy worship song that makes you feel like there's no one around except God and you got no friends and you hate life. Put on the praise. Stand on the rock of God's word and start to see things shift. I'm happy most of the time because I've learned the power of praise. Yes. I got to tell you, and I've been through some stuff. I've been through some situations that will curl your hair. But I've always been in joy because over time, the Lord has taught me the power of praise. Praise is an incredible liberator, and it's available to you and I today. Somebody say amen. Amen. Good. All right, we're coming to a close. Come on up, friends who play instruments. I need you. Help me close this baby down. Finally, one of the greatest liberators that you and I can avail ourselves of as Christians is the presence of God. The Bible tells us in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. The presence of God is an incredible liberator. So that's why here at C3 San Diego, we're not just about bringing you great messages. And we will bring you great messages. Yes. But we're also about cultivating a people who understand the power of spending time in the presence of God. Amen. And don't let religious people sell you a whammy. Okay, spending time with God is not like you reading your Bible for an hour and then marching across the room, praying in tongues and filling the airwaves with your voice, and then you put your Bible down and off you go to your merry life. No, you know, they're all wonderful things. I don't want to diminish the power of that. But have you ever just sat? Have you ever just sat in his presence and allowed yourself to be rebooted? You know, we're like smartphones. And we can't function and get the information we need and the downloads we need and the updates we need unless we're connected to Wi-Fi. It's called the presence of God. You know, and I love reading the book of Genesis. I've started reading the Bible through in a year, and I'm starting now for January to get ahead. So strange. Because I know I miss days. So I'm like, I'm going to start in November and January, and I'm going to trick God. I'm a strange human. All right, so I'm reading the book. So I've been reading Genesis, and it's so amazing. And I can't trick God. You know I'm playing up there on live stream, right? Don't write a letter, okay? She thought she could trick God. I was kidding. So I'm reading through Genesis in the creation story, and it's just so amazing because the Bible says that God created the earth, and it says, and God said, let there be light. It says, and God said, let's separate the waters from the earth. Let's separate the night from the day. Let's separate the light from the darkness. God spoke, and animals started to spring forth on the earth. Plants and herbs that could feed every living thing, and the ocean started to teem with fish because God said, God spoke. But then in Genesis 2, it starts to talk about the creation of man. And it's so different because God ceases to say, and he starts to get personally involved. And I love it because it says in Genesis chapter 2 that God formed man from the dust of the earth and then breathed life into his nostrils. So before, when he spoke and all of a sudden the earth came to being and the animals came to being, but he said, when I create man, oh, I'm going to get all up in their business. I want to be personally involved with this. And it just stands to reason that your creator, the one that knows you better, that you will come to life again in his presence and his touch, because that's how he made you. You cannot function outside of the presence of God. If you get nothing from this message today, and I know that's impossible, but if you get nothing else, get this. You will come alive if you allow yourself to linger in the presence of God. Oh, he's a personal God. And people will attack the Christian faith saying, oh, it's so narcissistic. You all talking about your personal relationship with God. Make it all about yourselves. No, we didn't do that. God did. Amen. He made it personal. He made it about you. He created man, formed him, and breathed the breath of heaven into his nostrils. He got involved. The Bible says, I am the good shepherd and I know my sheep by name. Think about it for a second. From the beginning of time to the end of time, and yet your heavenly Father knows you by name. Your creator knows you because he made you and he wants to spend time with you. When you're in his presence, that's when you come fully alive again. Everything shifts. The Bible tells us that Jesus was 33, about 33 when he died. But then the Bible also says, even though Jesus was 33, and look, he was in the prime of his life. He was in the prime of his life. He was a millennial. He was beast mode, making things happen. Hashtag epic all day long. I don't know if he was a hipster. I don't know if he wore the shirts with the holes and had a tattoo on his forearm in a different language. I don't know. I don't know if he sipped lattes at cool coffee shops and had a long beard. I don't know, but what I do know is this. The Bible says that Jesus often withdrew to the Mount of Olives to be restored in the presence of his Father. Oh, you and I can't live without the presence of God. We cannot live without it. It is our life's breath. God cares about you, friend. You're not just another animal. You're not a tree. You're so much greater. God got personally involved when it came to you. You and I come alive in his presence. And in this Christmas season, you know, I'm telling you, what's going to make or break us in what they call the silly season is the amount of time that we spend in the presence of God. And we see in the story of Mary and Martha, I mean, Martha was a hot mess. Oh, God bless her for trying. Look, she was a beautiful person. She wanted to so impress Jesus with her works. But then she reprimanded her sister and actually got Jesus involved in the fight by saying, you need to tell my sister what time it is. You tell her to come up and help me. And Jesus takes a minute and rebukes Martha and says, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. And I wonder how many people here today are worried and troubled about many things. There's so much on your mind. And he doesn't say, go do a seminar or go read your Bible more. You know what? He says, Mary has chosen the better thing, and it will not be taken from her. What was the better thing? Sitting in Jesus' presence. Take some time, my friends. It'll change your life. It'll change your life. C3 San Diego doesn't exist to bring religion and bring tradition and bring rules and regulations. The Old Testament is proof that that does not work. We've come to help you establish a long-lasting relationship with your Creator, your Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ. And you will be restored in His presence. And He's here right now. Love it if you'd close your eyes, bow your heads. I want to pray. Listen, the greatest symbol of liberty is not the Statue of Liberty. It's not the American flag. The greatest symbol of liberty is the cross. It is the cross of Jesus Christ. It was on that cross that Jesus Christ paid for your freedom and for my freedom. I love a story that Pastor Andrew tells about an incident that he had at a Merge Men's Conference. And he said he was sitting around the campfire, and as is typical at a men's Emerge conference, for those of you that have been, at the beginning of the conference, the men are given a burden. And on that burden, they write all their struggles, all their sins, all their shame. And they carry it on their back throughout the duration of the conference. And then as a symbol of freedom, at the end of the conference, they get that burden. They pray over it and they toss it into the fire, forever forgotten. And Pastor Andrew was sitting next to a young man around the fire, and the young man passed him his burden. And Pastor Andrew said, the young man looked so daunted at all the words that lay on his burden, saying to Pastor Andrew, how could God forgive this? How could God make this as if it never happened? I don't understand. And Pastor Andrew said, as he looked at the burden, that he too felt undone by the complexity and the bigness of the sins and the things written on that burden, on that piece of wood. But then the Holy Spirit spoke to him and said, Andrew, have this young man turn the burden over. So as he turned the burden over, Andrew said to him, what is on the other side? And the young man said, nothing. And he said, that is the power of the cross of Jesus Christ. There is no sin that is too big, too bad, or too complex that it cannot be undone by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. And there are people here today, and you've been sitting there thinking, just like that man, how could God erase what I have done? His blood is so powerful, my friends. The Bible says, though our sins were red as scarlet, God will make us as white as snow. The power of the cross. If you're here today, and you need to give your life to Jesus. You need to surrender your burden. There are people here today and you need to surrender your burden to the Lord, because there's no one else that can set you free. The Bible says that salvation belongs to our God. There is salvation through no other name and no other means than Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in the book of Acts, repent therefore and turn back to God so that your sins may be washed away. How beautiful is our God, friends. He doesn't say repent and return to me so he can condemn us and beat us and remind us of how we're filthy sinners. Bible says, repent and turn to me so that I can wash you, so I can cleanse you, because I'm going to forgive you of everything that you have done and give you a fresh start, a clean slate. I'm going to turn the burden over. If you need to surrender your life to the Lord today, that's why you're here. Lift your hand up nice and high.
Thank you so much for joining us online. We hope you had a powerful experience. We want to take this time to personally help you navigate the next steps in becoming connected. If you made a decision for Christ today, need prayer, or want more information about our church, go to our website, c3sandiego.com. And if you didn't get a chance to give online during service and would like to contribute financially, you can go to c3give.com and click on the giving option that works best for you. We look forward to hearing from you. See you at church.